thanks for coming and welcome to this session that is anticipated to be the most uplifting half an hour of the whole PosaFest this year. Uplifting is not going to be at all, but to avoid that at the end of this session you all start joining some survivalist club and movement, last minute before I was able to slot in a couple of slides at the end that may come across as a little bit forced, but at least we'll try not to make it too doom and gloom. Why am I talking about this in this creative forum? I'm not a politician, I'm not a sociologist, I'm not an economist, but the reason is because we need to talk about that. And starting with the premise that brands, and I'm a brand strategist, brands are stories, right? Brands are stories, that is what they are stories that we craft. They are based on a view of the world, they've got beliefs, they've got values, and then we are deploying these stories with symbols, experiences, and so on. The issue, though, is that while each brand has got its own stories, every now and then what happens is that there is a bigger story that come along on the horizon. And when this bigger story comes along, well, the whole frame of reference is reset. And we need to start reassessing those different small stories that each brand is all about. And that is what Trump is doing right now. There is a bigger story that we need to come to terms with. And it's actually not just Trump, because in many ways Trump is just the most recent phenomenon of something bigger, that is the rise of populist parties and people. Before was Brexit, right? In Italy, this guy, all of these guys have got some hair problem somehow, right? These guys are maybe the next prime minister of Italy, until recently a comedian. Nothing wrong with being a comedian, but certainly a bit of a scary approach to how to run a country. Most important election this year is going to be in France, and Marine Le Pen may end up being the president in France as well, right? What else? Even Australia is not in a better situation. The likelihood that Pauline Hanson can become a minority partner in the next government, I think that is something that can definitely happen. All these people, with all the endorsement behind them, are eventually building walls. Some walls are made of concrete in Israel. Some walls may be made of bricks. In a cash-stripped Europe, is more about sticks and barbed wire. You can choose your own walls. We are going to go down in history as an era of walls, right? Not that different from the Middle Ages, when all the cities were fortified. We are going to do this all over again. Now, in all of this, what is emerging is a separation of people through these walls. There is more and more of a separation and a division in terms of income and wealth. Just to keep this in mind, we talk a lot about inequality. Let's remember that since 1983 in the US, virtually all the wealth gains made by US families have gone to the upper income tier, right? And despite a couple of crises, there has been lots of wealth being made that is getting more and more concentrated. Australia is not as bad as the United States, but we are not the egalitarian country that we think we are. Let's keep in mind that the richest 7 individuals in Australia hold more wealth than the bottom 20% of Australians. And there is nothing that the government is doing to address a problem like that, if we believe that is a problem. So division in terms of people, division in terms of income and wealth, and ultimately also division in terms of opinion. As Trump was elected, we have read a lot about echo chambers, bubbles, and so on and so on. It's absolutely true. Very interestingly, I would like you to direct to an experiment that the Wall Street Journal did. And what they did, very simply, was setting up 2 different accounts, one for a person that would be liberal-minded, another account for someone red that is more a conservative-minded people. And they saw, day after day, why has you started to like and sharing a series of feeds, how fundamentally what emerged was 2 completely different words when it came to talk debates about election, abortions, guns, and so on. People sitting next to each other, they would have 2 completely different points of view on the Is that important when managing brands? Yes, because these brands are going to operate in a world that is divided. These brands are operating in a world where there is a collapse of trust. There is a complete implosion of trust. Whether that trust applies to governments, whether that trust applies to media, and ultimately whether that trust or lack of trust applies to business, this is what is happening right now. It's a completely different arena from the one that we were used in the past. It's a new arena where brands and their stories will be dragged into, willingly or not. You cannot stay away from that arena. You are part of it. You are part of it, especially in the United States, where, you know, Trump may wake up in the morning, early in the morning, and then he's going to tweet something about a company, whether it is to celebrate something that a company of his liking is doing, or whether it is to start bashing a company, right? He's doing it. That is unprecedented that the president of the United States is taking that approach, singling out specific brands, specific companies. Again, he may like some, he may dislike others, but actually, even you, if you were there to run that company, I don't know whether you would prefer to be liked or not, because either way, it's gonna be bad. You just want to stay away from it. You cannot stay away from it at all. And you are dragged into it. I don't know how many of you know what New Balance has gone through over the last couple of months. Do you? Right? So all of a sudden, the vice president of communication of New Balance decided to issue a statement, quite naively, somehow endorsing policies that were there, you know, to promote manufacturing in US. And New Balance is quite famous for being one of the companies making sneakers, sports equipment, using lots of factories in US. As you can imagine it, doing it right now was fundamentally interpreted as an endorsement of Trump policies, America first. So what happened was then people owning New Balances starting doing exactly that, putting fire on their shoes and starting taking posts of their shoes going online. The company went into panic, but that was not the end of it, because then a series of websites run by white supremacists decided to step in and give New Balance the prize of being the brand of sneakers of choice for white supremacists, right? And then there was no way to get out of it, right? Absolutely. And you can imagine many other companies are going through this. No matter what you do, there is a big risk there. Interestingly, all these companies, many of them, big and small, are somewhat associated to Trump, directly or indirectly, whether it is New Balance for an endorsement or not statement. This is an interesting screen grab that you may have a look at when you go back to your offices, that is a part of this initiative, Grab Your Wallet. And essentially, this is an up-to-the-minute list of companies and brands that you are supposed to boycott if you don't want to support Donald Trump, because there is some sort of association. And it keeps growing by the minute. It started with a dozen companies, moved to 30, now is 70. As I'm running this speech, is keep growing and growing and growing. And more companies, even without realizing, see themselves being a part in this list. Now, what brands can do then? Right? Brands can try to stay away from trouble. The problem, though, is that if you try to stay away from trouble, you risk being misunderstood, right? The simple fact that you don't want to have anything to do with it can be interpreted as you are essentially endorsing the new status quo, the new regime. Or you become irrelevant because people actually are asking for where do you stand, what do you think. You cannot be neutral. You cannot be the Switzerland of brands in a situation like that. You need to have a point of view. So what happens then is that whether you cannot, if you cannot stay out of trouble, if you need to have a voice, what we are going to see more and more, and that is not something that is happening for this month, right? That is going to happen more and more, is that brand will become more political. And when I say more political, I don't mean because they will side with a political party or a candidate. They will simply become more political because they need to stand up for fundamental values. They need to have a point of view. They will be required to have a point of view. And that is happening, right? First of all, the type of institution that was first under attack by Trump was the media, right? And the media had to have a voice, couldn't stay neutral. Vanity Fair has been a magazine in the US that has been under a special attack. And what Vanity Fair has done has been very overt with it, repositioning itself as the magazine Trump doesn't want you to read. Subscribe now. That has been a very successful subscription campaign. Not only Vanity Fair, but there are also some media outlets and brands that you wouldn't really associate with the brands having a political point of view. A brand and a magazine that is doing an amazing job is a Teen Vogue, something that would be naturally, normally associated with fashion and celebrities and so on. But actually, in this new climate, over the last year or so, they've started bringing in more and more political commentary, positioning, a new take of feminism, and so on and so on. That is happening there. The next in line is the world of fashion. The world of fashion is, by definition, the most apolitical sector that it exists, right? Fashion people don't want to take a position, also because it's difficult to take a position, because anybody can buy your clothes. It's not that you can stop that from happening. But even the fashion industry has been under the fire, starting with the question of who was going to dress Melania, right? Because that alone was going to be seen as an endorsement of that type of new presidency. Who dressed Melania? Ralph Lauren, who was smart enough to dress at the same time Hillary Clinton to try to maintain a neutral position. He was lucky because he got away. But what is happening in the fashion industry is that for the very first time, lots of fashion designers themselves are breaking free from the apolitical nature of the sector, and they themselves are starting to have a voice, right? And a political voice, right? Big, like Tom Ford, as well as independent designers. That is something that did not used to happen in the future. Next, and this is where the big guys come in, is the world of Silicon Valley, right? That has had a little bit of time of puzzlement and confusion, should we collaborate or not? And we are talking about bigger companies that may have the reason to collaborate, but even there, with the immigration ban, the executive order issued just in days ago, you can start seeing that those brands as well are doing it, right? In particular, Airbnb issuing a statement like this, that is a statement where this company, this brand, is fundamentally fleshing out, putting certain beliefs, certain values at the heart of the company, at the heart of their brand. Something that was not going to happen in different situations, right? Brands will be then expected to take a position on big themes. That is important. Brands more and more are going to take a position on big themes that transcend their products and their services. What the guy from Airbnb was doing was issuing a statement that had little to do with the products they sell, right? This is more about a deeper way of branding your company. This is really more about talking about what you believe in. It's more about defining the world of view that you want to embrace. That is going to happen more and more often. And being Italian, when these things happen, I've taken back, and I'm older than most of you in the audience, to what was happening in the 90s, right? You know, Benetton. And in the 90s, Benetton was doing exactly that. Benetton produced, and still produced, even though it's almost a dead company, really, right? Jumpers. And rather than talking about the color of their jumpers, this is the type of campaigns that used to run in the 90s, under the creative direction of Oliviero Toscani. Was about the mafia, was about the HIV epidemics. So essentially, they were going transcending the products, having a point of view on something bigger. What do they believe that the big issues of the world are all about? Then probably they lost their way, became just a source of a scandal and provocation. But what, and probably they were simply ahead of their time. What I believe that is going to happen is that we are going to see more and more brands starting playing in that type of space. Right? For those of you that work in the brand field, this raises an interesting consideration. Often when we define right brand strategies, often our obsession is about the credibility of brands. Are you credible in promising a certain performance of your products? The issue about the credibility is going to be less important in the future, mostly because people, consumers, will be happy to give you a go. Right? Okay, fine, let's try. The bigger issue is going to be about the legitimacy of brand. Legitimacy in terms of having you as a brand permission to talk about things that transcend your products and services, that have nothing to do with the performance of your product. That is going to be more important in the future. Now, if brands are becoming more political, right, and they are going to go deeper in what they say, what they will find themselves with is the question. But are we going to be polarizing, you know, on purpose, right? Saying things that can alienate certain people? Or are we going to bridge division the other way around? Which is an interesting strategy. If we live in a polarized and fragmented society, instead, at least let's hope that if not political parties, at least the brands are able to bring people together. Not easy, because in a divided community, in a community, US, you will see also Australia, that is completely fractured, even trying to bridge division is in itself an act of polarization. Right? And we've seen it in Australia just a couple of weeks ago. Because of all the things done for Australia Day, essentially, especially the things that were there to present an event as a bridge between different cultures and nationalities and so on, they have become the most controversial ads of all. You can try to be a bridge as a brand, but in this society, bridging is becoming an acting of conflict and polarization. It's not an easy thing to do. Brands then overall, they need to practice this deeper thinking, right? A thinking that is getting more political, it is getting more transcendental in terms of going beyond the products and service they have. The other important point is that being so deeper and being more about values, beliefs, these core ideas of what you stand for, what that means is that once you decide and embrace and reveal what your worldview is, then you need to stick to it. Right? You cannot change it overnight. And in a world like ours, especially in the field of brands, and not just, that is all about trying and testing and tactical thinking and trying to change, we may not be used to think like that, the long term, right? Because once you embrace a worldview, you need to stick to it. You cannot change. Otherwise, you lose all consistency, coherence, credibility, legitimacy. As part of these stories that the brands are evolving in this divided society, there are some fundamental questions that are important. And are important also because we know Pause Fest is a lot about creativity, is a lot about technology. The honeymoon with technology is over, right? What I mean with the honeymoon with technology is over. I'm not saying that in telling these stories to the world, creating these experiences, we are not going to use technology anymore. We are going to use more and more of it, whether it is more sophisticated social media, artificial intelligence, everything will be done more and more. But here I'm looking at it from a story point of view, right? We are starting to look at the technology under a different light and how brands may associate themselves to technology. To give you a better idea of what is happening here, I need to go back 18 or 20 years ago when I started my career. And I was lucky back then to work for a company that made home appliances, right? For those of you who may know it, Indesit is a company that is a pretty good, big white goods manufacturer out of Europe. I go back 18 years ago, and the best thing that I did while I was there, was big deal for the company, was launching this washing machine. Now, this washing machine was exactly like any other washing machine, but the big deal was that it had a display there, and through that display, you could receive emails. Now, Who is ever going to read emails on, unless you sit on the toilet and right in front of the washing machine? But was sold in big numbers, was a price three times more than the equivalent washing machine, and was ultimately used by the company as the brand building exercise, not just a product. This is essentially what we are all about, right? Is that washing machine receiving emails that is going to drive the company into the future. Why was that happening? Because we were in full honeymoon with the technology. Everything that smelled, sounded of technology was great. Every brand wanted to have a piece of the action, right? And in fact, that has gone on for quite some time. Even if you just go back 8 years ago, when Obama was elected, right? That is when we were having this type of conversation. Right? And essentially, everybody there was saying, thank God there is internet. Thank God there is the social media, because what they are doing is really allowing for a more participation, giving more power to the people, and ultimately allowing to elect this very smart, bright Afro-American intellectual. Right? Now, flash forward 8 years, right? Donald Trump has just killed Twitter. Has just killed Twitter, right? Already Twitter as a story had more the connotation of being a bit of an invasive, busybody type of friend, but now it's becoming more a pulpit for bullying people, an instrument of propaganda. And many people are simply getting out of Twitter altogether, right? So already is a different take on social media altogether. Or just think about this other big honeymoon that is over. That is a picture from the warehouse of Amazon, right? Where you don't see any human in sight anymore, right? It's entirely run by this robot, right? That's the way it is. Now, the assumption that we have always had is that, yes, this robot is going to take in some jobs, but new jobs are going to be created, the more sophisticated for humans. Why so? Maybe that is not going to happen this time. Those jobs are just going to be taken away, full stop, right? What else? Even the darling of startups, technology, the world of the sharing economy, that until a few years ago was seen, look, at least there is the sharing economy. These people are not doing it just to become billionaires. They are really doing it to help people run the economy in a different way. Well, actually, what we have discovered over the last year or two is that this gig economy presents many issues, many big issues. So all these things are opening up our eyes. I like this. This is from a debate of a couple of months ago, which says it a lot on how our relationship with the technology is becoming more problematic. As leak as it can get, but there is the question, is a technology now diminishing us? Right? And is a technology make us be worse than what we are? It's an important question. It's a question that shows that that honeymoon is fundamentally over. But not everything is bad news, right? Because it's more of a love-hate relationship between brands and technology. The point is this. We got to a level of complexity that unless we use technology, we are not going to get out of it, right? We have gone beyond that point of non-return. So even when we complain that technology, social media, has created all these echo chambers and bubbles, the point that we need to make is that there is no way that each one of us can get out of it unless we use a technology. And that is what Google is doing. So essentially, the only hope that we have is that there is some tweaking to their algorithm to ensure that those echo chambers are not created anymore. We are stuck in a way, right? We need to live with it. Or we may hope. Do you think that he's going to run for president? Who believes that he's going to run for president? Not many of you. He could run for president, maybe in 4 years, maybe in 8 years. Maybe that is the only hope that we may have, that is something like that, right? And I would say that could be a significant success. Or eventually, look, technology matters, because if we really are in such deep shit, the only way is to go on Mars with Elon Musk. And it's interesting to look at this, because In the past, these type of enterprises were enterprises that were run by governments. Governments don't do that anymore. It comes down to technology brands to do that type of initiative. There are big interesting reasons why we may go on that rocket and go on Mars. And it's because we are in deep trouble as the world. We are in deep trouble. We're not just in deep trouble because, you know, the economy is what it is, because of climate change. We are in deep trouble because we are currently living, and that has an impact on brands, in an atmosphere, in a climate of distrust, as I said before, but also in a climate of deep pessimism. The way that we have not experienced ever over the last, since the end of the Second World War. This is a survey done by YouGov across 20 countries or so. And the question is very simple. Thinking generally about the world, do you think the world is getting better and worse? Putting aside, and that was actually done 2 years ago, I think that the results would be worse than that. Apart from China, Indonesia, and other countries that are growing with their economies, look at the other countries there. Look at Australia, right? 70% of people believing that it's getting worse, right? I don't know what your opinion is, right? But that is essentially how people feel. That has a big impact on brands because whether we acknowledge it or we notice it or not, the way we think about brands, their stories, how we manage those brands, has historically been shaped by a climate of optimism, right? Even when I was trying to sell that washing machine, ultimately, I was sending a story of aspiration to people, right? My life in the future is going to be better than my life in the past. The life of my children is going to be better than my life right now. The life of my family, of my community, of my country was fundamentally a story of opportunities, possibilities, aspirations. That was the climate, right? That was the cultural context. What is happening, and that what was happening was that all the different brands were taking a little bit of it. Was a story of upward mobility, was a story of possibilities, opportunities, emancipation, aspiration. The problem though is that if instead now the cultural context is this, is a fundamentally a context of widespread pessimism, it feels like that someone is pulling the rag underneath the feet of the brands, because the whole context is changed. How much as a brand you can talk about possibilities, opportunities, and all of that, if ultimately the backdrop is this type of backdrop. It's bleak, as I said, it's not an uplifting conversation, but we need to come to terms with it, because raise some major questions about what the stories of those brands are going to be. Right? So what brand stories we will tell if in general people and a majority of people believe that there is no hope, no sense of progress in the future anymore, is a big cultural question that we cannot avoid. This cultural question in this new climate is especially harsh with teenagers, millennials, no matter how you want to call it. And this sort of implosion of hope in the future is happening under our eyes, is happening very fast. Think about it. For the generation of teenagers, kids of 10, 15 years ago, in many ways, the most, if you want, iconic story of their time was the story of Harry Potter, which ultimately is a story of friends helping each other, friendship. There is going to be an happy ending. The people who are good are going to prevail over the evil. That is what the story of that time was. Fast forward just 10 years after, right? If there is a story that defines the psyche of the same people of that age, of young teenagers, is instead the Hunger Game. Where nobody's helping each other, right? You're left on your own. There is unlikely to be in any happy ending. The world is harsh, heavily competitive. There is no way out. There is no way out. This is the type of stories, because we are talking about stories, that define the younger generation. The generation that is not voting, for whom we are voting on their behalf, but that is going to pay the consequences of what adults are doing right now. Can we finish in an uplifting way? It's a difficult one, but there is a little bit of a silver lining. I don't know yourself, over the last few months, if you have started questioning what you do, how you think, what you are going to do. But there is a point here, and that is from a lecture at MIT. And what he's saying is that, look, I mean, some of them, like myself, are more pessimistic than others, but we may expect that there will be chaos, confusion, maybe a sense of collapse, right? Maybe short-lived, could be longer than that. And most of those events are absolutely out of our control. But what we can control is how we respond to them. How we respond to them as a people, as a citizens, and also how we respond to them as a person that are in charge of managing brands, that have a story, that have a point of view. And if there is something that is heartening, is the fact that after an initial moment of confusion, brands have started to respond in a certain way. Go back just very current, the Super Bowl just a few days ago, where Airbnb both last minute, 30 seconds, 5 million, whatever that cost, put together a quick commercial, and that commercial was about that. Was a celebration of tolerance, acceptance, and a sense of belonging. They went political, right? They transcended what ultimately they sell, right? And they are taking a very clear position, even trying to bridge people, their knowledge that they are going to be polarizing. Interestingly, even Coca-Cola, right? The most iconic American brands of all, what they did was running their own ad. Interestingly, and differently from Airbnb, what Coca-Cola did was running an ad that was already an existing ad. Right? They had done it probably a couple of years earlier. And this, I don't know whether you have seen the ad, is an ad that is about singing American is Beautiful with different voices, with different languages, with different accents. Right? So it's really a celebration of togetherness. Was already an existing ad. Interestingly, what happens with brands and their stories is that when the context changes, those stories acquire a completely different meaning. That same ad that Coca-Cola would have run 2 years ago would have been seen as one of the usual cheesy ads by Coca-Cola, right? Done it in this context, all of a sudden, was seen as a big statement about what Coca-Cola believes in. This is an interesting thing with brand stories. When the context changes, the frame of reference changes so much, also your stories as a brand acquire a complete different meaning. And to finish, as I promised, with an uplift take, but it's relevant because the Super Bowl was about football. Let's talk about the real football, right? Let's go back to what was happening over the last couple of weekends. Let's bring it back to Australia. Right, we at Push worked to develop the Women's League for AFL that has been launched with great success. Right, of course, we did not create that brand in response to Donald Trump and all of that. Right, but I'm pretty sure that the thousands of people that went to the stadium, that went to see that type of sport code. Well, in their mind, they were reframing the story of women playing football in light of the current events. And what was originally probably meant just to be, okay, a women's manifestation of a sport that we love starts becoming a very important statement about what we believe in, what women are supposed to do in what otherwise is a male-dominated, pussy-grabbing type of presidency type of world. So it acquires a new meaning altogether. Right? With that, I finish. I hope that you are not going to leave this session and kill yourself. And